The purpose of this veritable trip back in time to the Whitechapel Bell Foundry in the City of London by a small group from the congregation of St. John's was to witness the casting of four new bells for the church. The new bells will, in the main, be both a visual and audible memorial to Tom Setter of Yeovil, who captained the bell tower for most of his 50 years as a ringer. And it is to the credit of Roger Fox, his nephew, that this project has reached this stage. The Bell Foundry was founded in 1570 on the site of the old Artichoke Inn, and a lead water tank in the original inn yard bears the date 1670. During its long history, the foundry has cast some magnificent bells, including Big Ben in the Tower of the Houses of Parliament, and much more recently, the bell which was carried by the Queen's barge during her Diamond Jubilee celebrations on the River Thames. We were privileged to share our visit with the Lord Mayor of London, not Boris, the Lord Mayor of the City of London, who was there with his wife and daughter and son. He too was interested in both the technique and the technology of bell casting, and of course the foundry lies within the City of London. We were able to look round the static exhibition in the foyer of the company's offices before venturing into the area where the bells will actually be cast. Two were cast in the morning and two in the afternoon. And we see there the moulds readied for the first two of the bells. So we will watch proceedings, which I think are fairly self-explanatory. The voice you hear in the background is that of the works manager, who is explaining some of what's going on, and the owner of the company, Mr. Hughes, is over on the right of this particular picture, supervising the pouring of the metal from the furnace into the ladle, which will then be used to pour into the bell moulds in the foreground.
Thank you. be guided and led through the work from the beginning through. Yeah, it takes about 3 weeks to make a back of the time. And we make it to all the drive and change the drive to load it together. So this week, Monday, we open the moulds, Tuesday, Wednesday, we get to the floor clear. By Thursday, we start to get up in the back.
When any metal is smelted, the impurities in the mixture float to the surface, and there you see the key operator pushing the impurities back so that as few imperfections as possible are actually used in the bell itself. Having said that, the impurities will rise to the surface in the bell mould too and will be removed in the finishing process.
St.John's in the centre of the city, St.John the Baptist.
Two holes on top of the wall, one of them is here, one we get to the last. We've been here to the line of where the air came up. We've been told to be a full run to be able to get the rain to be on that. So that's the size of the music. It's
the size of the music. The watch is on. It's been about 60 years.
Back to top it up, they're falling out of the mold. So there'll be a bell.
The pouring process is a real team effort. A gentleman manoeuvring the container of the molten metal, a gentleman handling the crane, the owner of the company, and the person influencing the pouring process. They all work together to achieve perfection.
Thank you.
pretty much completes the pouring process for our first two bells, and the second two will be dealt with this afternoon. But as a reprise, it's the opportunity to have a look through a series of still pictures of the same process, which give us the opportunity to dwell rather longer on each stage. The molten bell metal is poured from the furnace into the bucket, which is supported by an overhead crane, which enables that bucket then to be positioned over each bell mould in turn and poured in the fashion that you saw in the video film. The two bells are cast and then the bucket moves back again and is used for a topping up process to make sure that the mould is absolutely full. Bells are cast on Friday so that the bell will be cold enough or cool enough to be handled on the following Monday morning, so that the first of the finishing processes can take place. The first process, of course, will be the removal of the bell from the mould, or rather the mould from the bell. When the pouring was complete and the surplus metal in the cauldron had been safely stowed, there was the opportunity for members of the party to actually venture closer to the bell, particularly Roger and his wife Jenny, to stand alongside their protege. We then moved out into the yard for a talk by the works manager, and there's the lead water container that I referred to earlier, and members of our little group, together with the Lord Mayor and his wife, son and daughter, who were with us to witness the casting of the two bells. And there's the Lord Mayor standing behind Roger in that closer picture. On display there is a complete octave of new bells, which are available either for sale or for hire by orchestras and the like, and there were some very interesting and novel bell arrangements for us to look at.
It's like practice, you know.
So we give them cheery verses.
My high fault will get.
Yes.
So that's as it comes out of the mould, but the inside was grey. It's kind of, this is the graphite off the mould. But we've machined it on the inside to tune it. And I'll talk through with Ben about tuning.
Mostly not being tuned.
It's your existing third and fourth being tuned, and the four new bells will be tuned. So what will happen is the bell will come around here. When Ben's ready for them, they get turned mouth upwards on the lathe. What these old bells had the cannon loops on the top, they've been cut off in the past, so we're actually cast resin on the top of the bell to make a flat surface. We machine that flat, like this one's been machined, so that we can then drill through a bolt to the new fittings. These are from Fulham. Again, there's been some chip tuning done on these, but these are not being tuned, sadly. Fulham could badly have needed tuning, but they decided they like the sound of their bells as they are. So we're just having to put the pads on, machine the insides at the bottom to get a nice flat area for the clamp to bolt to. But these are old bells. Normally we would do corrective tuning work on old bells. If it's just to make a ring work around another listed bell.
It does depend why they're listed, because these Fulham bells are actually all listed, and they're listed because they were all not all 10, which in the southeast of England is quite unusual. Because
so these are 17. What's happened to all the Fulham bells?
This seemed to be a dispatch and also a storage area for a variety of bells and bell components. The beams being discussed with Roger are, in fact, components of our project and will help to support our new bells in the upper parts of the tower. Now some still images of the same scene without the background noise of the machine shop. We're now back in the casting area where we should see four bells cast, the larger two are our bells, and we look back into the oven where the bell moulds are formed and prepared. We also see four small moulds or pigs, hence the name pig iron, into which the spare molten metal is poured and reused. Here we see the furnace in the final stages of preparation prior to the pouring of our bell metal. here on the shapes hanging on the back wall of the room are in fact the profiles of the various bell sizes, large and small, which the foundry produces, similar to the one of Big Ben, which was in the entrance hall as we came in. Dante's Inferno, isn't it? As the works manager has just said, in the background there are approximately 2 tons of molten metal in the ladle, which is now going to be used for pouring the 4 bells in this afternoon session. They keep breaking off the impurities now. Yeah, I guess so. No, well, I don't know. Maybe the dross is what's in the bottom, is it? But boost must have molten metal when we were allowed to. It all comes to the top, actually. We climb up trees with it, and this all comes to the top.
All that charcoal, and it's stag on top of the metal. Throw on the top of the metal, fresh stag wagon powder. Doesn't need any impurities to do, like the top, all the bits of the skin.
after the initial pouring of the bell, a bonding agent is poured on top of the bell mould so that when the topping up stage is reached, the old and the new bell material will combine adequately. As a background to these still images, we listen to the existing bells of St. John's being run for the last time on the 28th of July before being dismantled early in August. here the works manager explains to us the forming of the internal and external bell moulds, which we have seen used now for the making of our bells. And the bell profile there is quite clearly seen. This gilded boss may be a representation of the patron saint, St. John the Baptist, or it may even be a representation of the Almighty. It sits above the high altar.